Spiky bits.
Hey guys, MBG back again with a video review of the new Imperial Armour Aeronautical book. It just came out from Forge World, of course. This became available, I think, towards the end of July, and it's just started getting into everybody's hands. It's a 112-page book with lots of rules for 6th edition 40K. It adds a lot of converts over a lot of stuff that was already existing and trimmed up some special rules and different things. It also put in the back the apocalypse appendices of converting apocalypse rules over to 6th edition 40K as well, which is kind of weird because apocalypse has been around for now 4th, 5th, and 6th edition 40K, because it was late 4th edition when apocalypse first came out. So it's kind of weird, but it's holding in there. It's one of the expansions with some sort of longevity to it, so that's good. This book, it's very good quality. It's a hardcover book, typical, you know, just like the other APOC books and stuff they put out. You know, lots of full color pictures and different things in here. There is a ton of vehicles. Let's try to zoom in on that. This is actually a preview they give on the Forge World site there. It kind of gives you an idea of what's in here. There's a ton of vehicles for just about every faction, except for, you know, Necrons and Dark Elder didn't get quite as much love. Chaos, surprisingly, and we'll get to that. Chaos was a rather interesting read. I'm very surprised by some of the stuff in there, and we'll go over that. But of course, you got your bulk of the Imperial Navy stuff, Imperial Guard, the Space Marines, Orcs, Eldar. Tyranids only had one thing. Sorry, guys. Tau's got, you know, a decent amount, and like I said, Chaos there. So that's pretty much it. In Aeronautical Imperialis contents there. It introduced five new and or clarified pieces of warrior, which, you know, may or may not have been around in the books before, but now we get a little bit more clear understanding of them and how they work in six with different things, Skyfire and all that, you know. There's eight new special rules. You know, similar to, you know, Supersonic and Skyfire and things like that. In 40K, we've got, like, Heatseeker and, you know, IR and Chaff Dispenser. There's something that unique paint job, basically. Like, if something can draw line of sight to one of these vehicles with a unique paint job that can take it, generally aircraft, they can re-roll them around, which is kind of cool, you know? Like, hey, the troops look up at the sky, see the Red Baron, oh, yeah, charge, you know, whatever. It's pretty cool. It's a neat concept. I mean, nothing in here is incredibly broken. I mean, there's a couple of things that are really good. There's one thing in particular that needs an FAQ almost immediately because it's not worded correctly, and I think you'll see that when I get to it. But anyway, so, you know, let's take a look at it. I like, as soon as you open it up, it's got these front sketch views of a lot of the more popular aircraft, that being the Thunderhawk there and a whole bunch of other ones. So that was kind of neat. Then we get to the contents. We already went over that. Some of the special rules. And this is what I wanted to show you. This is pretty sweet. Like, I wish this was a poster, because I would buy the crap out of it. And if it is a poster and it's on Forge World right now, I'm a big dummy, because I didn't see it. But anyways, this is pretty cool. Like, I used to have those aircraft posters when I was a kid. You know, it would show, like, you know, all the, you know, the planes evolving into the jets, you know, the World War II, and then the Vietnam, and then the Korean War, and then, like, the current stuff, which was, like, the 70s and 80s. So, you know, now I guess the F-22 would be there, and the Joint Strike Fighter. But that's pretty neat. I mean, this is kind of cool, especially now with all these flyers and stuff. This is neat to see. So I was really, when I cracked that open, I saw that, I was like, oh, man. It's not incredibly to scale, because the Cessus is way bigger than a drop pod, but, you know, I imagine the Mantis probably, like, as big as the page, but it's still pretty cool. I mean, you can't really knock that, so. Let's turn to my first bookmark here. All right. The Thunderbolt Fighter. That's pretty much been around forever, and that was one of the models I was talking about in my last video with the Avenger Strike Fighter that's probably starting to show its age, because it's been around about 15 years now, so. But it's actually pretty decent in this game set, so there's that one. Then we've got, I wanted to show this to you, because this is basically your cheapest flyer, one of your cheapest flyers, at least as far as I can tell. At 70 points, you can get the Valkyrie Sky Talon Transport, and, you know, don't even worry about the little buggy things. it could, you know, you could throw it with some rocket pods or a couple of Hellstrike missiles, and it's pretty decently armored. I mean, if you want to ally and not take the 130 point vendettas and stuff, this is almost half the points. And it's not too bad. I mean, it's a weird kit that doesn't see a lot of play, but game-wise, it might be pretty viable. I don't know. Let's take a look at my next one here. Ah, these were pretty neat. I was looking at these, I was like, holy cow. The little saber weapon battery platforms. There's one with a big searchlight that works just like you would imagine a searchlight does. But the really good ones are, you know, basically they all have interceptor and skyfire, which is ridiculous because a lot of people haven't figured out yet. And I was just playing a game the other day, and my buddy rolled 3 Storm Ravens on. And I was like, okay, cool, where are they going? And he's like, all right. And he put it in the middle of the table. And I was like, all right, I get to take my shots with my quad guns. And he's like, what? I was like, yeah, interceptor. Any reserves that come on, any reserves, not even flying, I can take shots at as long as I have line of sight. He was like, oh, my God. You know, and I did a lot of damage to one of them. But, you know, it just kind of softened them up. But you get to target all that firepower against one thing. You know, you never know. I don't know if you noticed on my blog the other day, I reposted something from Kirby talking about the different percentages for kills on Devastator weapons. So you showed that, you know, without factoring in Prescience, which is the divination reroll to hit psychic power, without factoring that in, you're looking at, you know, autocannons are far and above missile launchers at killing, you know, mid-range armor stuff, like your armor 10, your armor 11 stuff. It really starts changing around, like, up there at armor 12 or so. You know, it starts switching over and not being as effective. But most of the flyers, fortunately, are, you know, armor 10 and 11. So, except for the Storm Raven and some of the stuff in the Forge World book. So, you know, you're pretty much looking at autocannons that might be the way to go. And this thing can definitely take them. 48-inch range, strength 7, AP4, like normal. Heavy 2, Skyfire, Interceptor. 30 points per model and 1 to 3 in a squad. They count as artillery, the normal artillery stats, so that's good there. I believe, was it 30 points? What do these count as? I did not read that far. Oh, a heavy weapon squad. So that's not too bad. They'd be obviously more effective if you took 2 force organizations, but in a normal one, if you don't take as many tanks, maybe like a mana core, maybe like a Hydra battery or something like that, or you could free up your points for Hydras, because Hydras get really expensive really quick. So I don't know, it's something to think about. These definitely struck me as semi-competitive, and for the point, you know, points cost and real dollar cost, they're not too bad. So that was just one option that stood out to me. And then there was the Hyperius air defense platform, the Contemptor Mortis Dreadnought is also pretty cool as well. It has Interceptor and Skyfire. But this right here is awesome. 35 points each. You filled up to 4 of these things. They're automated. Who cares? They have the Heatseeker special rule, which basically makes them twin-linked. The only drawback that I can see with these things is that they have a lower toughness than the normal artillery. They're not the 7. 6 to 7 is kind of a, you know, it's kind of a deal breaker, but I think it's still worth taking. And the cool thing is, these, you know, both of these, you can actually upgrade one to the command, and it benefits you a little bit more. But both of these kits are separate kits that fit on the normal, you know, Razorback Rhino ring on the back of the tank. And then these little foot pads are actually the same thing as those saber defense platforms before you put the ring around it for the little dudes to stand on. So you got a lot of crossover with the different kits and stuff, depending on, you know, what you want to buy and different things. You can mix and match and switch things around depending on what you're fielding for allies and different things. So this really stood out to me too. I really liked these guys. Let's take another look at something I wanted to show you. Ah, the Nightwing Interceptor. I can't find, in my opinion, a better flyer than this thing. I mean, I just glanced at it, and I was like, okay, cool, it's got a Bright Lance, whatever, Strength 8, Lance, that's cool, yada yada, Shuriken Cannon, sure. But then I was looking at it, and I was looking at Special Rules, Deep Strike, whatever, Supersonic, okay, cool, so, you know, it can move fast if it doesn't shoot, if it needs to get dart out of there. Vector Dancer, which gives you an extra pivot, you know, you get to pivot before you move, and at the end of your move, you can do another 90 pivot, before you shoot and everything. Shrouded, we all know what that does. That's in the main rule book. That's your plus 2 to your cover save. Okay, so let's see. All right, so I got plus 2 to my cover save. Decide to jink. I get a 5 up. Plus 2 to that. I get a 3 up. Okay, cool. I guess that's good. Agile. Huh, what's agile do? Oh, plus 1 to your jink roll. Huh. So, wait a minute. You're telling me if I jink, this thing gets a 2 up? Holy crap. This thing's super survivable. A 2 up cover save on a flyer. Wow. No wonder it's 10-10-10, but still. I mean, this thing is just going to fly around and bug the crap out of everybody. I can't think of a better flyer in the game right now. I mean, the Doomsniper is nice with that death ray and stuff, but this thing is the death of all flyers. It doesn't have any air-to-ground options, but, man, this thing is smoking. So anyways, I'm not sure how much this costs, but I'm definitely going to be looking at getting one for my Eldar because, like I said, this thing is a flyer hunter. Alright, so let's take a look at the next thing. Next bookmark. Oh yeah, the Barracuda. It's rumored that this thing is, gonna come out in plastic. I don't know. For now, you know, it's a pretty decent kit for the Tau. It's a very good flyer. These things ignore all the bonuses from cover and different things for flyers because they're automated. So that's kind of cool. It's got a pretty good punch for air and air to ground overall for 130 points. It's not a bad fighter at all. I would definitely field some in Tau if they need it. They wouldn't even have to take allies. And let's see what else we got here. Oh, these two pages right here were very interesting. Let's take a look first at the Helltown. This used to be Apocalypse only. Like, this is the first time it's been allowed in 40K. Because it's actually pretty big. The model itself is like, you know, this-ish. But thing that really caught me off guard, I was like, wasn't this thing a bomber? And I'm looking at it, and I'm like, yeah, it is. Huh. Okay, it can take 8 tactical bombs. Alright, cool. What's a tactical bomb? It's the Heavy 1 Blast Bomb, 1 use only. So, you can take 8 of these things. It's supersonic. Again, like I was saying in my last video with the Avenger Strike Fighter, you can zoom on, do your bombing run, and supersonic off the table. Which is kind of a good strategy there. Sure, okay, what else we got? Heavy bomb, alright, what's that? Apocalyptic barrage, what? So, you can take this, you can upgrade this to heavy bomb, and then in a game of 40k, you can use the apocalyptic barrage, which is that cloverleaf thing. So you roll, each time you roll, it's like 1, 2, you know, each cloverleaf is a different thing. I think the middle one's like 4, 6 or something. But it's kind of weird that you get to take that in a game of, you know, 40K. So you can upgrade all 8 of your tactical bombs, if you want, to your heavy bombs. And then you get 8 rolls on, you know, a chart of 5, you know, basically 6 results. So that's pretty interesting for 185 points. I mean, it is going to get super expensive, but it's a viable option, I guess. I just thought that was kind of weird that they were going to bring that over to 40K. I think any competitive tournaments might want to watch that one. I've heard of people, the Damocles Command Rhino could also do the same thing. It was like a 60-point Rhino, lets you reroll the reserves, but you could also get the Apocalyptic Barrage. Some places don't let you play with that because it's an Apocalypse-level mechanic, so I don't know. I don't know if it's worth taking if, you know, you can't use that, whatever. The bombing run is still nice. Come on, carpet bomb, fly off, come back, you know, start blasting stuff. That's pretty viable, too. Let's talk about the Dreadclaw. This was written wrong. Completely wrong, actually. It was almost a complete cut and paste from the last book. And they didn't update how you deploy out of it, first of all. Because there's no more deploying within 2 inches of the hole kind of thing. You know, you basically get out within 6. You can do, and it's weird because it functions as a flyer, but it also functions as a drop pod. So, according to this, the Dreadclaw Assault, you know, it begins the game in reserves and enters using deep strike rules. Okay, sure, cool. So deep strikes in, bam, I'm here. After it has arrived, the Dreadclaw may move normally. I think that needs to be changed to the turn after it arrives, it can move normally. Because, I mean, granted, you can only run after you deep strike, but they didn't really, you know, word that in there, right? So somebody could be like, oh no, it comes in and now I get to use it as a flyer. Nah, I don't think that's the way they meant. It comes in first, and then it functions as a flyer. But I think they need to clean up a little bit about how, you know, how the whole deployment within 2-inch thing, because you basically get out within 6. So the way I think it should read, and again, this is all speculative, is it comes in, boom. It's technically a fire, so you can say, you know, how fast it's going or whatever, in case it gets locked in to, you know, locked into that velocity or whatever. And then the next turn, you can say, all right, cool, I'm going to go into hover, which you can do. So I'm going to go into hover, I'm going to move 6. And then the dudes are going to get out 6, because it's assault boat. So I'm going to get out, I'm going to move 6, the dudes are going to get out 6, 2d6 charge, yada yada, whatever. The cool thing about it is, it's 3 hull points, it's 12 all around, it functions as a flyer, it's 85 points, it's a little pricey, you know, it's way more than a normal drop pod in any list, but it gives you options, it lets you place your stuff pretty good in the Chaos Army. We don't know what's coming out for Chaos, but I think they just need to clean up this little bit right here, and it'd be pretty golden. I can't really see anything wrong with it. I mean, granted there's some confusion on how it should or should not work, but I think once they clear that up, maybe in a brief FAQ or something, you know, it's good to go. But we'll see. Maybe we'll get a plastic one in Chaos. I don't know. I'm not opposed to it. I wouldn't mind that at all. Then we got our last bookmark here. Oh, actually, I wanted to talk to you about the campaign setting. Oh, there's an actual campaign setting in here. It goes over, like, the fluff in the background. They give you some maps and some rules and different things, some different scenarios. Mostly for, you know, flying around. It's basically, it kind of feels like the campaign's a little Avatar-ish, you know, they're trying to get through the jungle and to this thing and do the stuff and, you know, just to incorporate a lot of flyers. You know, the story's written around basically what they want to do, which is make a book about flyers and sell flyers, but whatever. It's kind of neat. It's a new thing. It involves Chaos and Imperium, some Space Marines mixed in, so I liked it. It was cool. Apocalypse Rules Appendix. They basically changed the Apocalypse Rules, which this is actually a free download right now on Forge World's website. You can get all these, the Apocalypse Appendix, where they basically switched it over to the new 6th edition rules. Like I said, 3 editions, Apocalypse has been changed 3 times. Whatever, it's fine. It seems to flow pretty well still. The structure point, hull point thing, each hull point is worth 3 structure points. Pretty easy to figure out. They changed the damage table, to be a little bit more in line with the actual damage table for vehicles. You don't necessarily lose your structure points right off the bat. You still get the reroll on the charts. You know, if you keep rolling the 6s, it's good. But it's a little bit more resilient there. And then they go into the drive damage and primary weapons still have their save. The only thing I noticed that I really didn't agree with, they really nerfed the Eldar Hollow Fields. It used to be an invulnerable save, which I think definitely benefits the Eldar. Now it's just a straight shroud, 2 plus your cover save, which doesn't do anything against D weapons. So how are you telling me that my Titan doesn't get any sort of protection against another Titan's weapons? The Hollow Fields are supposed to protect against that. So I don't exactly agree with that, but that's the way they did it. However, you know, changing Rage now, Angrath, that huge bloodthirster, that 888 point bloodthirster, is actually super viable now. He does have to charge the closest thing, but he does not have to move towards the closest thing. And he actually has more attacks now, which is pretty dope. So, you know, you get every edition, every time something comes out, something changes, different things, but, you know, that's pretty much it. So, we get what we get there, but it was really good. They went ahead and updated the Apocalypse Rules right off the bat, so I was pretty happy with that. Overall, I definitely recommend this book. It's worth getting just for, it's the first hard copy of the Apocalypse Rules. It's got a lot of other additional rules in here. It's just a nice book. It's got a built-in campaign. You know, it's just it covers a lot of stuff. It's actually a pretty good value. You know, the other Apocalypse books weren't as good of value in my opinion. But you know. That's pretty much it. So, you know, all in all, I definitely think it's worth picking up if you have the opportunity to / the need. I'm pretty happy with it. I'm just kind of mad it took like 2-3 weeks to get here, but you know, can't complain about so much. So, anyways, I'm MBG Rob Bear. I hope you enjoyed my fair use video review of this new product, Imperial Armour Aeronautical from Forge World / Black Library. Thanks for watching.
Spiky bits.